kissed her and she kissed me. Like the fella once said, ain't that a kick in the head? The room was completely black. I hugged her and she hugged back. Like the sailor said, quote, ain't that a hole in a boat? My head keeps spinning. I go to sleep and keep grinning. If this is just the beginning, my life is gonna be beautiful. I've sunshine enough to spread.
Well, hello, everybody. My name is Jason DeCosta. Thank you for joining me, and welcome to my show today. That was the man, Dean Martin, and called Ain't That a Kick in the Head. And I like the fact that he said, ain't that a hole in the boat? In other words, the full preterist view that we've been taking a look at, which we call inconsistent preterism, has more holes in the boat than you can imagine. And what people don't realize is that every time one of these little holes pops up, the water kind of seeps in and the view just kind of sinks. And eventually, it's going to be so full with water that it'll be a problem. And for those of us who are already well into this, we can see that the boat is already at the bottom of the Atlantic. There are others who see it, but they still think that boat is afloat and hanging in there, fighting, kicking, pushing. But that thing has Titanic'd, my friends. Today, we're going to be talking a little bit about a few things. I am in Vancouver, Canada right now. I enjoy this city very much. It's a beautiful place. If you have never been, you should get out here, especially the downtown area where you look across the bay and you see the mountains, the snow-capped mountains, and you got these seaplanes landing and a big statue of a killer whale right on the water. It's pretty cool. It's a unique place. So get there. Anyways, a couple nights ago, on Tuesday night, Michael Miano shared an audio on his Hairy Ticks variety show. And in that audio, he had sort of responded, to my earlier audio I shared during the day on my YouTube channel, which was about, the title was Israel to be a light to the nations around them? And this is Michael Miano's main premise in his debate with Michael Bradley, and it's the one thing that he is holding on to with all of his might to sort of prove somehow that today somebody, I don't know who, but some sort of Israel is being a light to nations around people. It's really inconsistent. He really doesn't have a lot of proof. It's very clear, but that is his main focal point in all of this, and he will fight that to the T. But I'll be showing today why, number one, it's not true. But again, if you haven't seen that already, very clearly. But also, I'll be showing that even if it were true, let's say all of this was wrong, okay, and Israel was actually created in the Old Testament times to be a light to the nations around them. I will show you why that has no bearing on anything today, and why that means nothing in terms of where we are today. But so I'm going to be taking a look at his audio, and what happened was that he posted a link to the Hairy Ticks show Tuesday night on my YouTube video that I shared earlier that day, and it was perfect because I was on my way to Vancouver. I was bored. I was on a 4.5-hour flight, and he posted the video sort of right in the middle, so it was perfect. I got a chance to listen to it on Wi-Fi up there, 30,000 feet in the air. And killed about 63 minutes of time listening to that. And then I took some time to respond to all of his points briefly and concisely. And I actually commented on his link that he posted on my video. I put all of my comments there so people could see them. So today I'm going to be speaking a little bit about my points, reviewing them, comparing them to what he said. And I'm also going to be adding in a few little tidbits of joy as well that'll get your gears really cranking upstairs and make you think, really, wow, I never thought of it that way. So Michael presented this Harry Tick variety show, and to me it was more of an emotional speech than anything, really. I was waiting for him to explain and exegete passages. I was waiting for him to take the time to explain to me how the fullness of the Gentiles and the fullness of all Israel could have already been saved, and yet somehow he today and I today are somehow part of this story that came in fullness and ended. Jesus said, go and preach, and then the end will come. Well, Michael says, go and preach and continue to preach because there is no end. All right, Jesus said, Paul said that the fullness of the Gentiles would result in all Israel being saved when they came in before the end of the age, and it would be at that time when the new covenant was established and Jacob's sins were forgiven. Michael Miano says, well, sure, the fullness of the Gentiles came in, and that resulted in all Israel saved, and that was when Jacob's sins were forgiven, but we can be forgiven today too. So really, there's just so many contradictions in Michael's statements, and what I'm going to do today is I'm going to show you a boatload of them and bring them to the light, okay? He did say that he liked my memes, which I thought was cool. You could tell he was a little bitter about them. He called them backhanded type remarks and comments or whatever. But he did, read a couple of them, and he actually took a liking, I think, to the one with the three ladies who were talking about what type of Holy Spirit they chose. And one lady says, I went with the Arminian, infant baptism style. And then the other lady's like, well, we thought about that, but Bob and I chose the slightly Calvinistic, most things are fulfilled, but we can choose a few things here and there that pertain to us. Baptism, water baptism doesn't save or whatever. So point was that, people just have, different flavors of the Holy Spirit. It's like you go to the little ice cream shop and it's like, hey, what type of Holy Spirit would you like? Would you like sprinkles with that? But anyhow, so I'm going to talk a little bit about that, and my computer keeps making these frog sounds, so if you hear them, just disregard. But basically what it seems to me with Mike and what he's doing here is he's kind of, it reminds me of a man who's in over his head. What I mean by that is he stepped up thinking that this was just kind of going to be a debate and then it was all going to go away, but really it's not going to go away, and he's in it now. And he's got IO proponents who are very wise in the view and understand their Bible better than he, coming at him from left, right, up, and down. And the sad thing is he doesn't have a lot of help, because I think the more older and wiser proponents of full preterism would rather just stay away because they understand the view and where it leads. And it's logical conclusions, so they'd rather stay away. And like one guy said on Facebook, they'd rather argue stupid futurism, which is so true. So I'm gonna go over my comments. I'm gonna discuss a few things, and hopefully we can get you to think a little bit harder here on some topics. So the first thing I want to talk about is something that I thought was absolutely astounding that Mr. Miano said in his presentation. Now, I didn't record it word for word. I was kind of jotting things down as he was speaking, but you can go back clearly on his Harry Tick show from Tuesday night, and you can listen to it in full if you'd like. But I'm going to be basically outlining, not word for word, but paraphrasing some of the things he said. And one of the claims he said is that he never said that outsiders have the law of God on their hearts, okay? And I couldn't believe this type of statement. It really kind of almost knocked me out of my seat into the aisle on the airplane. They would have had to call air security to come and take me out. But luckily, I stayed in my seat. I caught myself. But I couldn't believe it. So he says nobody has a law in their heart today, and he never said that. Because I brought the attention to, on one of my memes, the fact that God in Hebrews 8, even though most full preterists get this wrong and they think that Hebrews 8 is about us today, that God says that there's in the new covenant, he would write his laws upon the hearts of those in that covenant. So I said to him, I said, well, if God is, I didn't say to him, but in my meme, I kind of made the point that, what point is it that God would, say that he was going to write his laws on the covenant people's hearts? And what about all those outside of the covenant? Did they have the laws on their hearts? How do they have the laws on their hearts if God is only, sort of declaring that he would write his laws on the covenant people's hearts? And Michael's response to that was, I never said anybody outside of the covenant had the laws on their hearts, okay? And so what he did is he just trapped himself without even knowing it. The whole premise of Christianity today is that there is a law on the heart that'll judge, okay? Nobody will deny that, although Miano may. That's what Christianity is, okay? There's no Mosaic law imputing sin. People know that. It passed away. So then how is anyone guilty? Even the most ignorant futurist Christians understand, falsely and wrongly, of course, but they believe that there is a law on each of our hearts, a moral law, if you will, that is imputing or excusing us. In other words, we will be judged by this law written on the hearts in the day of wrath, which they, you know, get from Romans 2, of course. So they look at this law in the heart and they say, look, you know, that's your conscience. Whenever you do something wrong, that's the law. You're breaking the law. So totally wrong, by the way, totally unbiblical, of course, but that's how Christians are guilty. I mean, that's how people are guilty today, according to mainstream Christianity. So my thing is, if Michael says that he never said there's a law in the outsider's hearts today, then how is anyone guilty? How is anybody even violating any kind of command from God? What type of gospel is Mr. Miano even preaching then, if he doesn't have people violating a moral law written on the hearts? And therefore, that leads into what exactly are people being redeemed from today? What are people being saved from today? What is the blood of Christ washing over people for today? So you can see that Mr. Miano's claim here in his audio that he never said people outside of the covenant have the law of God written on their hearts really just backfires in his face, and it shows that he is in over his head and doesn't realize what he just said. All right, but let me explain something to you that I really want you to grasp, okay? So this is just a little side note that I haven't included in the notes or anything. I'm just going to say it here. So in Hebrews chapter 8, if, for those of you who have watched my two sticks equals the new covenant equals new heaven, new earth audio from a few days ago, maybe a week ago, if not, check that out. But this comes from that. So I'm convinced that Jeremiah 31 is all about the return from Babylon, where God brought the house of Israel and the house of Judah back to Jerusalem. He made a new covenant with them, which means a new temple, a new land, a new law, a new, you know, everything. It was just a revived land. It was the dry bones coming up out of the land and coming back, God breathing life into them. It's all this imagery. It's the joining together of the two sticks, which we know were Ephraim and Judah, which is the northern kingdom Israel and the southern kingdom Judah. All right, so we know that, to me anyway, the entire context of all those chapters in Jeremiah, go read them if you haven't, Jeremiah 29 to 33 specifically, and then of course in Jeremiah 31, right dab smack in the middle, we see that God is bringing them back and establishing a new covenant with them where he writes the laws on their hearts. The young won't have to know them, the old won't have to know them because they'll all know them from the least to the greatest and so on and so forth. So, pardon me for my deep breaths, I have a bit of a cold and it's kind of affecting my breathing, but the point here is that Jeremiah 31 is all about the return from Babylon, all right? And when people come to Hebrews chapter 8, they mistakenly today assume that that is speaking of a new covenant with us today where God has written the laws on our hearts, all right? But that's false. All right, what the author of Hebrews is simply doing is he's mentioning the portion from Jeremiah when Jeremiah was talking about the first covenant that was flawed, that being the Sinai covenant, where God came in. He judged the northern kingdom with Assyria. He judged the southern kingdom with Babylon. He took them both captive. He spread them into the nations, and then collectively he would bring them back and establish a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that he made with their fathers when he took them out of Egypt. This is all from Jeremiah. But he would establish a new covenant where he would write their laws on their hearts. So the point here is that Hebrews chapter 8, all the author of Hebrews is doing is he's quoting and referring back to those two covenants. And then at the very end, he says, for that first covenant, something I'm paraphrasing, I don't have it in front of me, but the very end in verse 13 says, that first covenant has been made obsolete, talking about the one in Sinai. And he says, now what is becoming obsolete and growing old is about to vanish away, being the second covenant when they came back to Jerusalem from Babylon when the laws were written on their hearts. Okay, so that was the covenant that was about to fade away. But people miss that completely. That's not the point here. I already discussed that, and I'm fully convinced. But here's what we really need to think of, okay? So if your position is that all humanity has a law written on their heart, okay, and that God inscribed his laws on our hearts from the beginning, every single person, no matter where they are, who they are, when they lived, they all had a law in their heart which will either accuse or excuse them when they die. Now, that is overwhelmingly the majority rule in Christianity, and everybody listening to this video knows that, okay, except for maybe Mike Miano now because he's up against the wall. But the point here is that why would God, okay, when he brings Israel out of Babylon and brings them back to the land, why would he make this special declaration, which was only pertinent and relative to them and nobody else, okay? Why would he make this declaration that he was going to, quote, write his laws on their hearts? All right, let's think about this. If all humanity, since the beginning of time, has a law written on their hearts that God put there, then why would God specifically go out of his way to mention that Israel and Judah were going to have a law now written on their hearts? It makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. If all humanity already had a law written on their hearts from God, then Judah and Israel would have already had that law written on their hearts. But God makes this special declaration saying that when I establish this new covenant with you, the law will now be on your heart. And not literally, okay? It's just metaphoric. It's figurative language for meaning that they would be engulfed in the law. It would be super important. It would be a part of their everyday lives. They would meditate upon it day and night. But that's a huge point that people don't consider, and that's really a game over point in this whole argument. You see, what happened was when God wrote that law on their hearts, okay, when he brought them back to Jerusalem, that writing of the law on their hearts sets us up for Romans 2. And what I mean by that is when Paul in Romans 2 is talking about those outside of the law who would be judged by the law written on their hearts, he's referring back to when God brought the children of Israel back to the land and established this covenant where there was a law written on their hearts, okay? Meaning that they would be guilty if they violated it. And so those who were not observing the law, who would be judged by the law written on their hearts in the soon-to-come day of wrath that Paul talks of in Romans 2, the same soon-to-come day of wrath that Jesus assured would happen before some of them died, is simply just that. It's Paul pulling from the beginning of this covenant where God wrote the laws on their hearts. Again, showing that this was all about them. The ones who had the law would be judged by it. The ones who did not have the law would be judged by the law written on their hearts. Okay? Very easy. But that is a sort of a hole in the boat, Dean Martin type idea there that people don't consider. If all humanity had the law in their hearts, why is God declaring that the house of Israel and the house of Judah in this new covenant when they came back to Jerusalem will have the law written on their hearts? It makes absolutely no sense. but back to Michael Miano and his contradictions. So Michael Miano, in his opening statement of the debate with Bradley, in paragraph 2, he says this, quote, "It should be marked just as unfair for Mr. Bradley or adherents of the IO view to claim that I am only holding my view because I serve as a pastor of a church, as it would be for me to claim the only reason they hold to this view is because their hearts aren't right with God." Well, he says his heart, speaking of Bradley, but prior to that, he speaks of the adherents of the view. So collectively, what Miano's saying there is that it wouldn't be fair for him to say that these men hold the IO view just because of a heart issue, okay, or a heart matter. So he said that in his opening statement, and that was maybe last Thursday, okay, so a week ago. And then in his audio 2 days ago on Tuesday on the Harry Ticks Variety Show at minute 11:45, okay, he says this, quote, "I am becoming more and more convinced that the IO view is a heart matter," end quote. So, wait a minute. 1 week ago, he said that it's not fair for him to believe that it's a heart matter with these guys, and he doesn't believe that. And then 1 week later, in his Harry Tick show, he's saying that he's becoming more and more convinced that IO is a heart matter. So, which is it, Mr. Miano? Consistency is key. I think you've said that many times. So, just another one of Michael's pretty funny contradictions there. But we're going to get into some of the comments of his video. And that I made on his video, and we're just gonna kind of roll with it and let the juices flow. So Michael had a 63-minute presentation where he made some unbelievable claims and some extremely strawman type arguments. I'm just gonna kind of review some of the points. So Michael initially said that this view is nonsense, he called it in the video. He also said that quote, many are frustrated that he even gives it attention, it being the IO view. So Michael's claiming that people are upset that he is actually stepping out on the front lines and trying to take down this giant, if you will, which is total BS. I mean, this couldn't be, this is just unbelievable, okay? A month or two ago, I'm not on Facebook, but I was told that there was a new group made specifically for this called IO versus Christianity. All right. And the reason why this new group was made was because of the growing demand and interest in the view. All right. And there's over, I think, 200 members in that view right now, in that group right now, from what I've heard. Okay. Not to mention every preterist group out there in Facebook is talking about IO. All right. Not to mention, I am repeatedly getting texts, calls, emails, whatever, comments, asking questions about IO. All right. So for Michael to say that people are frustrated that he's even giving attention to it is absolute crap. Okay. I can assure you that there's a growing interest and demand for these answers. Okay. And it's at an all-time high. So his statement is super false, not even just false. He made that up, and people are really interested in this stuff, okay? They've heard the arguments of myself, they've heard arguments of others, and that's why you see such noise and dirt and dust being kicked up everywhere now. And Michael is acting like there's nothing even worth addressing with the view, which is funny, because in his opening statement, he spent maybe 3 or 4 pages of his 10 pages telling us how much he agrees with the IO view. So which is it? Is it the fact that this view doesn't deserve attention because it's so false? Or is it, like you said in your opening statement, that you agree with a lot of what we actually say? Another contradiction by Michael. So Michael also said in his audio that he agrees that preterist teachers and leaders should step up and focus more on explaining and figuring out what happens after AD 70. And I said to him in my comment, here's a hint, Mike. If you can't see it clearly, there's probably nothing there. All right, there's only so many passages that we can look at. And I can assure you that myself and others of the view are very anal and very diligent to make sure that we're understanding things properly. All right, we don't just settle on something because we read it once. Okay, we go back, we fact check, we compare it, we let the Bible interpret the Bible. There's that computer sound again. It keeps telling me someone's birthday is tomorrow. And it gives me the option to close or snooze it. So I snoozed it last time. Let's try to close it. But anyways, we're very confident in what we propose with the IO view and our ability to intelligently decipher and navigate through the narrative. All right. Although he might think that he's the only one that's capable of doing that. Mike in his audio also referred to IO people as being in, quote, mass confusion. I think he's got that backwards, though. Who's really the confused ones here? It's surely not us. He said that it's a heart matter, like I said before, but how so? Is he suggesting that we need the Holy Spirit to give us a new heart, which was only relative to Israel, and which was actually a promise to Israel in Leviticus chapter 26 about giving them a new heart and circumcising their heart? This was also something that happened to Israel when they were brought back from Babylon. If you read Ezekiel 36 and 37, you can see that God was going to create a new heart in them. He was going to put his spirit in them. He was going to remove their heart of stone and give them a heart of flesh. This is all relative to Israel's history. So Michael, again, is very confused. All right. Again, he also says that we're attacking the modern institution of the church. But honestly, that has nothing to do with it. I don't even care about the church anymore, like as far as, you know, buildings and gatherings and meetings. If you want to do that, you can. That's fine. That's your prerogative. But in all fairness, he knows that it's just a big game. It's totally unbiblical. The ecclesia was the ones who were being called out of the body of death, okay? They were the ones that were being called back by the gospel. The ecclesia was not a building. The ecclesia was not an institution by any means. It was just a group of people who gathered together. It was the people. It was not a building. And he'll, you know, he made some example in his thing that, oh God, I can't even remember now, but I wish I did, but it was just really funny. And he goes on to defend the building, the church buildings, as like, it's, you know, it's no big deal and everything. But the fact of the matter is that, you know, you're engaging in a institution, and you're running an institution that takes in money from people, and that, you know, that is doing this totally unrelated to what the Bible says, commands, suggests, anything. It's not even in there. Okay. So if you're going to do it, that's fine. Do it the best you can, help people out. I get that. That's cool. But don't act like it's a biblical thing. Don't act like it's a command of God today, because really it's just a game. It's just, you're just playing church. It's unbiblical, and he knows it. The difference between the IO people and Miano and his cohorts is that we actually exegete the Bible. All right, we exegete it daily. On my audios, those of you who know, and not this one because I'm doing a rant to combat his rant, but on my audios, those of you who listen to me know that 80% of the words that come out of my big fat mouth are scripture. And I rely mainly on those. I don't really try to go anywhere else with it, okay? The IOers understand the Bible far better than most of these guys, and they know this is true. That's why they've blocked guys like Rivers of Eden, and that's why a lot of them don't even engage. And they call us atheists like Mr. Preston does. So Michael talked about my audio from Tuesday. He did not like my assumption of his dishonesty. He didn't appreciate it. And I responded and said, I don't appreciate him defending something he knows is wrong. Mike is not a fool. Neither are the likes of Preston, Bell, Curtis, etc. These guys have been in the game. They've been in the Bible. Okay, when little nobodies like myself, Bradley, whoever else, Corey Schultz, Rivers, Michael Barris, Timothy Matthews, you know, all these guys, when we come along and we see this very clearly and expound on it very clearly and can see it without any reservation, then the question needs to be at least asked, why not these vested men? Why can't they see it? Mike says he doesn't appreciate our backhanded comments. Well, how about you deal with the points that are presented to you rather than dancing around them? All right, you mentioned that he's going to present in his rebuttal coming up maybe today or tomorrow, who the elect were in the Bible and why the elect are still here today. Well, this is odd, because all those who needed to be sealed and saved were saved before the end of the age. So this should be really fun to see where he takes this. But even more so, I hope he realizes that this next section that he's going to do is called a rebuttal. All right, and a rebuttal means that you're to refute the evidence presented in the previous section. But either way, whether he decides to ignore the mountain of evidence that Bradley pinned against him and go just with, you know, building up his own new argument on who the elect are today, which is going to be funny. Whatever avenue he decides to go down, it's going to be fun and exciting to see his ideas on the elect. And like I said in my comments to him, the elect are actually one of my favorite topics, so I'll be sure to be paying attention. I told him that he's inconsistent. He's a covenant creationist who teaches that Adam was not a universal head, and yet somehow he has people being saved today from Adam's curse. How? How does that even work? Confusion. He calls us confused. That's the personification of confusion right there, is that stance that he holds. Let's see. He says everybody's in constant confusion in the IO view. I don't know about that. Seems like everybody's very clear about what I talk about. Those who reach out to me tell me how clear it is. It's only really those who are in defense mode who are battling against the view who suggest it's confusing. Personally, the view has brought me much clarity in the Bible, more so than any view prior to this. And then he says, why do we want to trigger them? You know, with these memes that I share that have the little triggered thing on the side. And honestly, the first thing is it's just fun. I have a sick, twisted mind in some regards, and I enjoy being creative with it. God's given me the ability to, think on a whim. So composing memes is kind of a fun activity for me when I'm bored. Things just come into my mind and I get a chuckle. But mainly the other reason is because of the dishonesty. These guys are flat out dishonest. They don't deal with the facts presented, such as how are we saved today and from what and why. Okay, I've asked that question to Preston, to Bell, in the interactions back on Facebook. Everybody saw it. There was no answer, just a lot of smoke screen. How are we Israel today? Okay, which I'm going to talk about shortly, how Miano now, you know, conveniently doesn't say that we are spiritual Israel today, but I know for a fact he once taught that. We all did. But how are we Israel today if all Israel was already saved? What curse are we under if the curse was the law and the law is gone every jot and tittle? Okay, just like Daniel in chapter 9 says, when the temple fell and the abomination made desolate, it would make an end of sin and it would finish the transgression. But Michael Miano says that no, it didn't make an end of sin. It made an end of sin for those of Israel, but we are all still under sin. He says, no, it didn't finish the transgression. It finished the transgression for Israel, but we are all still transgressors. So Michael talks about leaning upon his own understanding, and he accuses me of leaning upon my own understanding, and he chuckles like he's, you know, like he knows something. But the fact of the matter is that Michael's whole theology is a contradiction. And he is basically leaning upon his own understanding to the 10th power, okay? And I think I'm showing that very clearly. He keeps saying that people have refuted I.O. And I said, if you think your presentation was a refutation of I.O. or anything that any one of you has presented was a refutation of I.O., you guys are out of your mind. If this is the best that they have, then they truly have nothing. Everything that I've read so far in his opening statement and listened to in his Harry Tick show was laughable. There's been nothing. There's been no scriptural refutation. There's been opinions. There's been fluff. There's been beating around the bush. There's been emotional arguments. There's been attacking us for attacking them. You know, and he's going to try to play the whole loving Christian card, like, hey, these guys are not loving. They're not compassionate. But you know what? Look, I have always been a no BS guy, okay? In every aspect of my life, people will tell you. I've lost friends over it. For instance, a guy that I used to be friends with on Facebook, a few months ago, before I got off, he said something to me like, oh, you know, we can learn something about God from his interactions with Israel. And I said, oh, yeah, well, what? You know, explain it to me. And he really didn't have any good answer. And I just told him, I said, you know, I disagree. I don't see what you're seeing. And, you know, and I basically just told him, I don't bullshit, you know, sorry for the lack of term, but I don't. And he didn't like that, of course. And that was, you know, basically the end of our communications. But that's the type of guy I am. You know, I'm not going to sit here and fake to be a somebody who I'm not. I'm not going to sit here and put on the fake Christian cloak like everybody does. I'm going to tell it how it is. And that's exactly what I'm doing here. And that's not going to change. So, but the funny thing here is that these guys just truly have nothing, you know, and they act as if the view has been refuted. Well, if the view has been refuted, Michael, it would not be gaining momentum like it is now and causing all the uproar in the communities. Okay, there's a reason why, and because the reason is because people can see the truth in it. When things aren't true and when they're laughable and funny and they're a joke, like futurism, you can kind of laugh at them and joke around about them. But when things are true, they ring true and people recognize the truth in them. And that's what you're seeing happening right now. Michael said that the first century saints were the bride and groom. And I'm probably going to do a teaching on this at some point because this really needs to be jumped on. Michael claims, and many claim, that Israel, the first century saints, were the bride of Christ. They were Israel, all right, and the elect. And some of them may even claim that the Gentile foreigners, even though there were none, but the foreigners were part of that bride, all right, at the end of the age that Christ came to take when the marriage was consummated. Michael claims that, and he gets this from Alan Bondar as well, who, by the way, believes in tithing because he believes we're under the Melchizedek law or something. I don't know. A guy recently told me that 2 days ago that he lost all respect for Alan when Alan began talking about, you know, why we need to tithe today. But the funny thing is that they believe that when this spiritual marriage was consummated, that children began. All right. And so my question is, well, okay, so Michael claims now, and I'm going to explain this in a minute, that nobody's spiritual Israel today. All right, well, when Christ came and took the true Israel of God as his bride, and they consummated the marriage, and Michael believes that somehow spiritually they're having spiritual intercourse with spiritual condoms, and they're producing spiritual babies, okay, well, wouldn't those be spiritual Israelites? Wouldn't the babies that he claims come from Christ's marriage with his bride, which was the true Israel of God who went into the New Jerusalem, wouldn't those be spiritual Israelites? But yet Michael claims that nobody's spiritual Israel today, even though he did claim that a year ago when I knew him. So again, just another huge contradiction. Of course, let's play devil's advocate here and say that those were truly foreigners that were brought in and they were the bride as well. Well, then who were the children? Okay. And where, what kind of children are they? Are they Israel? Are they Gentile children? What is it? Okay. And why was there a full number of foreigners who needed salvation before the end of the age, if indeed the foreigners were foreigners, like Michael claims? that's such a nail in the coffin type thing right there. If you think about it, there was a full number of Gentiles, meaning those out in the nations, that needed to be brought in before the end, and that would result in all Israel being saved, said Paul in Romans 11, and that would be the point when Jacob's sins were forgiven. But Michael doesn't understand that and never addresses it. I mean, never addresses it, and I hope to God he does in this, in one of these rebuttals, because this is such a crucial point. Why were there a full amount of foreigners that needed to be brought in before the end? Okay, because he thinks that the Gentiles that are being converted are foreigners. But all those foreigners were already saved, according to Paul in Romans 11. Of course, we know they were Israelites that just lived out in the nations and were being called back. But devil's advocate, let's say they were foreigners. Why were they all saved? All right. Michael said there's a lot of psychosis at play, and in our view, which was funny. He claims that the phrase God never changes. He claims that he never said this. I mean, this guy is out of his mind. This is a Christian staple. Okay, this statement. Everybody says it. God never changes. God doesn't change. God's the same today, yesterday, and forever. That's all they ever say. Okay, Don Preston said this to me many times in our interactions. Others have said it to me nonstop. Okay, to suggest that he's never said this is a flat out lie. We all have, including myself. So again, just another example of Michael's dishonesty here. He says that we have bitterness towards the church institution, which has pushed us to this IO view. No, actually, he's got it backwards again. The realization of the IO view came first. The bitterness came as a result of seeing how clear it is, and then seeing guys like yourself and other pastors and big players dishonestly shun the arguments away without ever truly locking horns with them, just like he did in this Harry Ticks audio, just like he did in the opening statement of his debate, and just like he will do today or tomorrow when the rebuttals are released. Watch, mark my words on that. There'll be very little exegetical proof, and there'll be very little engaging in Bradley's points. Specifically that point that I just told you about the fullness of the foreigners, the so-called foreigners, coming in before the end. Michael said in his audio that God's purposes, God had purposes that are still being fulfilled or something along those lines, but he speaks as though God's purposes involved people beyond those who already received their inheritance. God's purposes came to their fulfillment at the end of the age. That was when the gospel ended. God took his bride, and they were delivered back to the Father. This is just more inconsistent preterism. Michael talks about Acts 13 and how there's silence on that because it says, "You, those in Israel and those among you who fear God." Basically, it's just proselytes. Everybody knows this. Mike doesn't understand that those who were under the law, proselytes included, were guilty of sin. They were part of the covenant. They were violators of the law, and they needed the blood of Christ to wash over them. They needed salvation. All right. And Michael's unaware of all the passages in the Old Testament that say this clearly, that if they came under the covenant commandments and were circumcised, then they were considered an Israelite and part of the family. There are very many of those passages, and I'll probably have to do a teaching on that soon. But by the way, this is what I was talking about earlier about Michael's whole argument that, you know, foreigners could join to Israel's covenant back then. Michael's whole argument, and all these people argue about this point, saying, oh, look, you know, foreigners could come under the covenant and be circumcised and join Israel. Well, yes, that's very true. But this point bears no weight upon the argument here that all Israel was already saved. Okay, so what they do is they say, look, there was foreigners joining Israel's covenant back in the Old Testament. And therefore, that translates somehow to foreigners joining a covenant today that's not even here, okay? It doesn't, all right? The fact remains that the fullness of all those who needed salvation received it. Both all Israel and all Gentiles, aka those in the nations, already received their inheritance. If they did not already receive their inheritance, then there would be no new covenant, and Jacob's sins are not yet forgiven, which means Christ's work meant nothing yet. And you're back in futurism, the muddy waters of futurism. But of course we know that they were all saved. The fullness of the Gentiles came in, and thus all Israel was saved, said Paul. And this was the time when the deliverer came out of Zion, took away Jacob's sins and delivered the kingdom back to the Father. That was the end of the story, folks. So whether or not these foreigners joined themselves to Israel's covenant in the olden days, which they did, that bears no weight upon the end of the story. All right, there's nothing that translates today from that fact that foreigners could join Israel's old covenant. Nothing at all. All right, they're relying on this way too much, and they're not proving it with any sort of relevance or passages in the New Testament. They basically just say, oh, that's my argument. They could join in the old so they can join in the new. No, it doesn't work like that. Redemption, the promises, the adoption, all the inheritances, they all came to pass. They were all received, and all those who needed the forgiveness did in fact receive it. And then, of course, Acts 13 at the very end tells us who the Gentiles were. If you read around verse 47 or so, Paul is saying, as many Gentiles who were appointed to eternal life believed. All right, and that's elect. When you're appointed to, you're elect, okay? You're chosen, you're predestined, you're appointed to. And who were the elect? Well, we know they were the diaspora. Peter defines them for us clearly in 1 Peter chapter 1, the elect diaspora out in the nations, okay? So they were the diaspora, and this can be proven very clearly with nothing but the Bible. Let's see. Michael continuously repeated that he agrees with many of the IO texts that they were exclusively about Israel. But my thing is, when is he actually going to show texts that actually prove his side of the view? It's like he keeps agreeing with us on certain passages and never gives us anything that actually speaks about these so-called foreigners and never really explains to us why we're part of the story today. Okay. Let's see. He said that he was going to address some of these points here, but in this audio that he did in the Heretics, he didn't address any of my points or any of Bradley's points. So I'm really hoping that in his upcoming rebuttal that he gets into that and actually addresses these points. And now back to the spiritual Israel thing. Michael claims that he never said we're spiritual Israel today, which is astounding, okay, because he always did. We all did, all right? It's funny how him and others changed their tune about this really discreetly and quickly once they realized it was impossible for them to be Israel today. I kind of have a keen eye for noticing shifts in momentum and shifts in the frequencies out there, if you will, and I've noticed that ever since I started showing this stuff about Romans 11 and how all Israel was already saved and the fullness of the Gentiles already came in and so on and so forth, these outspoken proponents of full preterism have sort of changed their view ever so gently and slightly so as to not, you know, set the alarms off and let people know. But now all of a sudden, Miano doesn't believe that people are spiritual Israel today. Okay, well, then what are they? All right, who's entering the new Jerusalem today? All right, it's not spiritual Israel. Funny thing is, we know during those last days that the true Israel of God was being saved. If you want to call it spiritual Israel, fine. There's no term in the Bible that says that, but okay. So let's say spiritual Israel was being saved throughout the last days. Well, guess what? All spiritual Israel was saved. The fullness of them all came in and Jacob's sins were taken away. So it ended, all right? But it's just really funny how they all once taught that we are spiritual Israel today, aka the true Israel of God. And they know this too, but yet now all of a sudden, no, I don't believe that. Jesus was asked, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? All right, this was all about Israel. He said, I think he made the comment of, you know, I hope you guys are able to understand our place within the narrative of redemption. And I said, actually, no, we can't. That's what we need you for, to help us. Can you help us understand? And we're still waiting to hear some valid and logical, intelligent answers, and scriptural, more importantly, as to how and why we fit into this. Michael said this about my comments in my audio. He said, how offensive. I understand the intentions of human hearts, is what I told him. I understand that people are dishonest and they're greedy and they'll protect their comfort zones when backed against the wall. And I think that's what he's doing and what many others are doing. And based on the sheer lack of being able to handle these scriptural arguments, it's pretty clear that I'm correct. He talked about Bradley using more scriptures than him, which he kind of agreed. And in fact, you know, Bradley did use way more scriptures than Mike, and anybody could see that. We don't need Mike's opinion on the story. We don't want to hear, you know, what he has to say about his opinion and the meta narrative, which is just complete crap. He says he's in agreement with many aspects of IO, but then he's not in agreement in certain areas. He talks about my presentation from Tuesday, where I talked about how God absolutely destroyed nations for the sake of Israel. I just want to read you one thing. Let me pull it up here real quick, because you know, Michael's whole argument is that Israel was to be a light to these nations around them, all right? And key there, nations around them, all right? Well, let's see what God tells Israel to do to the nations around them, all right? In Deuteronomy 7, verse 1, we read this: "When the Lord your God brings you into the land which you go to possess, and has cast out many nations before you, the Hittites and the Girgashites and the Amorites and the Canaanites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites." We can make a song out of this. "Seven nations greater and mightier than you. And when the Lord your God delivers them over to you," ready? "You shall conquer them and utterly destroy them. You shall make no covenant with them, nor show them mercy. Nor shall you make marriages with them. You shall not give your daughter to their son, nor take their daughter for your son." Blah, blah, blah. All right? So let's see. Does God want Israel to be lights to those nations around them? Let's read it again. "And when the Lord your God delivers these nations around you over to you, you shall conquer them and utterly destroy them. You shall make no covenant with them and show them no mercy." Wow, Mike, that sounds really, really good. I mean, that's really going with what you're trying to explain here. Unbelievable. I think that text explains itself. I don't really need to get into it much, but again, God is telling them to wipe out, destroy, and have no mercy on the nations around them, while Michael Miano tells you that God was actually secretly telling them, you know, have mercy on them and be a light to them and show them the goodness and compassion and the truth of God. Total nonsense. Let's see. So yeah, my passages that I quoted in my presentation on Tuesday were connected, and he said they were just randomly plucked, which is absolutely nonsense. They were indeed connected because they show collectively God's heart towards outsiders as compared to his heart towards his apple of his eye, Israel. I formed a fluid composition of Israel's history, which is chock full of mass slaughterings by the God that he says desired to attract the nations around them. It's just really crazy that he can even deny this. He mentioned these men who he mentioned in his opening statement, these pastors like Preston, Curtis, and Bondar, and these are all deeply vested pastors. But, you know, he claims on one hand that he's already dealt with IO and the IO view, but I had a conversation with Rivers of Eden maybe a week ago, and a good conversation, just getting to know each other a little bit, and first time I had ever talked to him, and he told me everything about what happened, how Preston blocked him, how Miano blocked him. They chose to ignore it. They wouldn't even let Rivers engage his stuff. I mean, Rivers is a pretty polite guy. For those of you who have, you know, interacted with him, he's not a jerk like me. So for them to block him really just says a lot. I mean, they didn't want to deal with the arguments, so they got rid of him. And it sounds to me like his claims are not true, that he has dealt with IO. It sounds more like he's run from it. And just now, I think he's sort of been put on the spot by a lot of people as a self-proclaimed apologist. That he's now going to, you know, step up and be the guy who takes a stab at this IO thing. And really, it's not going well, let me tell you. And I think people are starting to see it. There's a few, you know, fools out there who claim that, you know, these arguments have been good. But of course, these are the guys who want more than anything for IO to just go away. They're begging IO to go away. One guy told a buddy of mine to hang himself because of this, quote unquote. And I kid you not. But anyways, Michael says that he presented a narrative in his opening statement, and that he's going to, you know, work harder on that in his rebuttals, and that's going to be good. I can't wait to see how he tears down all the scriptures that Bradley brought forth and then proves that the elect are being saved today, even though Revelation 7 and 14 show that all the elect needed to be sealed on the forehead before the end could come. Then he talked about this thing called a meta-narrative, which was just so funny. It's like, I don't know where he gets this stuff. He must, like, have a direct connection to God that tells him, you know, all these fancy words. Basically, a meta-narrative is sort of like a narrative within the narrative that sort of is a master narrative, if you will. So basically, you know, we can all just kind of pick and choose what type of meta-narrative we think the Bible's concerned with. Words don't mean anything. Story doesn't mean anything. Details of the story doesn't mean anything. God telling Israel to destroy and have no mercy on the nations around them, that means nothing. Basically, we can all just kind of imagine up our own meta-narrative that, you know, there's a much deeper meaning within all of that. Let's see. I think what I'm going to go with is God wants us to eat pizza and cheeseburgers every day because he drove Israel's people out from around them in the nations. Yeah, that sounds good. I think that's going to be my meta-narrative. This is just so ridiculous. Mike doesn't realize what I just told you about Deuteronomy 7, that God actually tells him to destroy these nations to the uttermost. So Mike believes that God kills nations to draw them to him. So, and then Mike said this, quote unquote, he said, God is trying to be seen by other nations through the actions of Israel. So basically what Mike is saying is, God, this is God's mindset. Come to me or I will kill you. That sounds like a great gospel invitation, doesn't it? Mike doesn't realize that his whole premise is that God desires to know other nations. That's his whole premise in this debate, and it has been so far. And that's what he's hinging his whole arguments on here, is that God desired to know other nations through Israel, by using Israel. But yet Michael totally ignores the Old Testament, such as passages like Amos 3, which God tells Israel, you only have I known of all the families of the earth. So which one is it, Mike? Does God really want to know all nations when he's telling Israel and Amos and other places that them alone has he known of all the families of the earth? Something's just not adding up. Just another one of those contradictions. He mentioned Rahab and Ruth, which, again, to me, has nothing to do with the redemption that we're talking about in the New Testament. These guys are really good at pulling up Old Testament examples of faith and whatever they meant in their context, and then somehow suggesting that that means something for us today when the story concludes when all Israel was saved. This is what I'm talking about. We can argue over the fine details all we want, okay? We can argue over who is this guy? Who is Cornelius? Why does this say this? Why does this say that? And most of the time, the Israel-only view has a good answer for it, 95% of the time. Sure, there are a few that need work and that, you know, are challenging, and we don't, as I've been proving here, we don't have the full story. The Bible is not the full story. I don't care what anybody says. You have a 400-year period of silence between Malachi and the coming of John the Baptist. Clearly, that's a long period of time. We're talking generations there of things that happen that we really don't know about, that we can see in other books like the Maccabees and whatnot, but clearly the Bible is not everything that we need to know. So the point is that but what we do have is we have the conclusion, all right? So we can argue all we want about the fine details, but the conclusion is very clear, all right? And that is that all Israel was already saved, all those who needed it. Again, he talked about me leaning on my own understanding, yet I'm the one who relies on the Bible and nothing else. If you've listened to Michael's Harry Tick show, and if you've read his opening statement, you can see how little scripture he relies on and how much talking and fluff and opinion he goes into in his own things, in his own ideas. Like when he talks about Adam being given light to give to those around him, which I'm still waiting for him to provide even one passage that says that Adam was to go and give light to the nations. There is none, and that's why you won't get it. But he's the one relying on his own understanding, not I. He says that this one was great. Ready for this? He says that I probably didn't have a good understanding of preterism and Christianity, which has led me to my IO views. But lest we forget, Miano endorsed my first book, The Kingdom of Christ. He wrote a quote on the back endorsing me. If I had it right now, I'd read it because it was very humbling and flattering. He also commended me time and again on my clear ways of teaching and being able to bring clarity to such difficult areas of the Bible. Ironically, now, though, because I've gone to IO, he has gone back on that and instead now says that I did not have a good base understanding of it back then. It's just super funny. Just another contradiction. He's working on a 12-strike contradiction here pretty soon. Mike kept saying that Jason doesn't understand the conquering mentality of Israel. What the heck is he even talking about? We were all hoping that he'd elaborate that on that in his Heretics show, but he did not. How does a conquering mentality jive with a loving God who desired to know all nations around him? It doesn't. It's stupid. So when a foreign war general wages war on another country, what Miano is basically comparing, he's saying that war and that genocide attracts those in that country who were affected by his invasion. So these people, after they lose everything they own, their homes, their possessions, their loved ones, they now want to know the guy who murdered them all, and they want to love him and covenant with him and be with him. No. How dumb. Okay, the conquering mentality of Israel argument just was really, really unbelievable to hear. Let's see. Michael said, God gave Israel the law to increase the opportunity to be a light. Huh? I thought the law was a bondage and a curse, said Paul. I thought the law was the ministry of death, said Paul. Mike's analogy at the end about a child who got hurt was horrific. Again, he says that Adam was given light for the other nations, but he's not provided not even one passage that provides that proves that. So we're all still waiting on that, Mike. Hopefully you'll include that in your rebuttal. Then he said that my way of interpreting the Bible is the lazy man's way. I can assure you there's nothing lazy about my studies. And then he said this about his upcoming rebuttal, which I thought was incredible. He said, quote, don't expect me to pull rabbits out of hats with verses. What? What does that even mean? Is this a setup so that we are let down easily when he doesn't use solid or convincing passages to prove his point and he doesn't engage Bradley's arguments? Are we yet again to just take his word for it on his meta-narrative concept, which I've never even heard of? It's just amazing that he would even say that. To me, that shows that he already sees the writing on the wall, that he doesn't have arguments for this, and he wants to kind of let that out there before this rebuttal comes out. Don't expect me to pull rabbits out of hats with verses. No, we're not expecting you to pull rabbits out of hats. We're just expecting you to explain the Bible the way that you seem so sure you understand it, which you haven't done yet. He then talked about Deuteronomy 4 again. This seems to be his go-to passage, but it really has nothing to do with Israel being a light to other nations. It had everything to do with Israel not profaning God's name. That's it, plain and simple. Mike's added his own opinions, his own meta-narrative idea, and he's basically, there's nothing in the text which would even suggest that. So all in all, you know, with Michael's heretic presentation, he's offered up a rant that dealt with nothing. It was loaded with contradictions and problems, doesn't address anything. God told Israel that only them he knew of all the nations, yet Mike says that God desired to know all nations. Mike says that God's desire was to draw nations to him through Israel, yet God told Israel to drive nations away. All right. Michael says that he never told anybody that there's a law written on the hearts today. Yet every single Christian pastor in the whole entire world says that we're judged by a law written on our hearts. All right. Michael is just chock full of contradictions. And like I said in the beginning, he's in over his head. But it'll be interesting and entertaining to see his rebuttal today or tomorrow, whenever it comes out, and see if he can actually attempt to, engage some of the points that are really looming over his head. And the last thing that I wanted to talk about was the idea of, you know, people get mad at us because, you know, we'd say that the gospel was for Israel and that it was Israel only, but yet they don't realize that they've actually excluded everybody prior to the gospel age. So however many thousands of years that people lived on this earth prior to Christ being born, those people had no hope. Those people didn't hear any gospel. Those people, according to these people, died in their sins. Those people, according to these Christians, had no way to be saved, okay? And some of these guys come up with some really funny stuff. Like, if you ever ask them about that, they say, oh yeah, Jesus went down into Hades and he preached to the dead, and all those people who died prior, Jesus preached to, and if they believed while they were down in Hades, then they're going to be raised at the resurrection. And, it's just unbelievable the stuff that these guys come up with. But think about that. According to these guys, nobody prior to Christ's coming or to Christ's ministry had any hope. They all died. They have no hope. Only us today, post-Christ, have that hope and that gospel that can reach us. So they're guilty of the discrimination, probably even more so than we are. But what's funny is they talk about this this whole like going down into Hades and preaching and everything, that's really the only chance they have. Although some of them say that if they express faith in God prior to Christ, then Christ's blood washed over them in some sort of futuristic way. I mean, there is just so much nonsense that's so unbiblical. But we know from the Bible that none of that is true, and that the resurrection was the hope of Israel, and that only they would be raised. All right, and it never had anything to do with anybody else. Like Paul said in Acts 26, he says, "They knew me from the first, if they were willing to testify, that according to the strictest sect of our religion, I lived a Pharisee. And now I stand and am judged for the hope of the promise made by God to our fathers." Now, ready for this? "To this promise, our 12 tribes, earnestly serving God day and night, hope to attain." So I'll read that again. He says, "And now I stand and am judged for the hope of the promise made by God to our fathers." Those are the fathers of Israel. He says, "To this promise, our 12 tribes, earnestly serving God day and night, hope to attain." That's Israel, okay? The 12 tribes of Israel. So again, the hope, the promise, the resurrection was all for Israel. It didn't include anybody else. That's why we have the sheep and the goats. Those are both clean animals. They were raised and they were split. So everything relative to the resurrection and coming up out of Hades, or you know, awakening from the dust, like Daniel calls it, which he was speaking of his people, is all relative and pertinent only to Israel and nobody further. So again, just another inconsistency that needs to be brought to light with these guys, that only if you were born after Christ do you have any hope, and only if you hear the gospel do you have any hope. Now, all these people who in the world today who have never heard the gospel, who live in regions where the gospel can't get to them, who live in jungles, wherever they are, those people are SOL, we call it, they have no hope because they haven't heard the gospel. So yeah, a lot of good stuff going on in Christianity. But anyhow, I think that's all I'm going to talk about for today. This will probably be the last teaching I share today. I share this week. I may share one tomorrow if I have the chance. I have a conference here today and tomorrow in Vancouver, and I should be pretty busy. But if I don't share another one, I hope you all have a wonderful weekend, and we will be in touch very soon. Take care, everybody.
Kissed her and she kissed me. Like the fella once said, ain't that a kick in the head? The room was completely black. I hugged her and she hugged back. Like the sailor said, quote, ain't that a hole in the boat? My head keeps spinning. I go to sleep and keep grinning. If this is just the beginning.